put the sit over here.
Yeah, we're good. We're still waiting for the other class to. It takes me just a few minutes.
Class next period for it.
So how do we get this long? That we have to do the lunch line, right? She doesn't do the lunch line. Bring you right through. How's that sound?
That's fine.
Good morning, gentlemen. I'm Mrs. Daly. I head up the advancement office, which is also known as the alumni office. And I have had the privilege of knowing Mr. McQuillan, John McQuillan, class of 1983, for the last 12 years since I've been at VC High. And John is one of the premier in his field of environmental science. And Mr. McQuillan's story started out, he went to BC High in 1983, grew up in Winthrop, and went on to Bowdoin College. When he graduated Bowdoin, he started working for a company that is now his a competitor. And he said, I can do this better. So he saw what they were doing and knew he could do it better, and he has. And so without further ado, I introduce Mr. John McQuillan. He is a trustee of BC High, a very generous donor. You might know McQuillan Hall is named after his parents. And he's going to be a great speaker for you today and share with you some of his knowledge in the field that you are studying in the classroom and how he's applied it. So, Mr. McQuillan.
Thank you, and thank you, Mrs. Daly. I love to work in this room. It's a beautiful room. It's a testimony to the generosity of Finbarr Cadigan, who gave us the money to build this big, beautiful building and take advantage of our position right here on the waterfront. And it's just a whole lot of fun. Well, as Mrs. Daly had suggested to you, I was a BCI kid, graduated in 1987, went on to Bowdoin College, went to graduate school at Harvard afterwards, and have spent my whole career in the environmental field. And environmental protection has been something that's really interested me ever since I was a kid. I organized beach cleanups on Winthrop Beach, and I'm really blessed to find myself in an industry that I have a passion for, and I would encourage all of you to think about what you're passionate about in your career and pursue what you do, because as a practical matter, as Americans, we have to all go to work, and we might as well really enjoy what we do, and I encourage you to think about what you enjoy doing and then go ahead and do it. Quick agenda set out here. The first thing I'd like to do is just talk about my company, the company I built over the last 28 years, and then share with you an idea that we had for recycling projects that we went out to our customers and talked about and really brought to life. And I'd like to share also with you the execution of that idea, and then at the end, just give you some tips from me, a 50-year-old guy who was once a 17-year-old guy here at BC High, and what my career from BC High to being a sustainability entrepreneur has entailed. So with that agenda, I wonder if we could play it. I have two quick clips in the middle of this PowerPoint, and the first is, this is just on my company.
Triumvirate is a North American environmental company offering waste management services, technical services, and field services.
We put a lot of effort into providing our services to only four primary niches: the higher ed, the healthcare, the life sciences, and the industrial markets.
From tank cleaning to remediation projects to decontamination facilities.
To our professional services, which is compliance consulting and on-site environmental health and safety management.
And we see a lot of interconnectedness between all those services, so typically with that interconnectedness, we can provide a solution that's very different than many of the folks in our industry.
It has become a very diverse company, it's very progressive.
It's a Boston-based company that has expanded exponentially over the past 25 years.
If we can give a holistic approach to our clients, ranging from startup biotechs to the petroleum industry to universities and hospitals, etc., we can give them a bundled service package that gives them a comprehensive review of all their environmental health and safety programs.
It's providing all of these clients with the high level of service and that wow factor that we really put into every job that we do.
That's really what the wow is. It's exceeding expectations over and over and over again.
The service level is absolutely critical to Triumvirate's success, and it really starts with the people. And when I say that, it's really about a team and a family, and I think that's what Triumvirate's all about. That's the core foundation of Triumvirate.
The hiring of our employees is where it all begins. They're enrolled in a Triumvirate University, and Triumvirate University is going to help them develop the core competencies necessary for them to do their job. It's going to take them to the next level. It's going to help them advance through the company so that they can move into a much more advanced and even expert role.
It's a multifaceted approach to getting people up to speed on the regulations, the technical side of things, the client interface.
The group that we had at Triumvirate was very unique. I really firmly believe we hire the best people in the industry.
We have a variety of staff here that are exceptionally well-versed in remedial technologies, as well as general environmental construction and emergency response.
With the personnel we have, with the assets we have, with the mission and values we have the ability to put trained personnel that know the situation, know the market, and know the cutting edge of the regulatory framework in that particular market in order to get the job done.
We knew if we could create experts within those niches that we could really bring a much higher level of premium value to our clients within those niches.
We're always trying to find ways to make sure that every system we have adds benefit and adds value to the clients.
That's what our job is to do, is to keep them informed and keep them in compliance.
And really just challenging ourselves every day to think differently.
It's being not only on the cutting edge, but coming up with solutions and being ahead of what the client's needs are.
And that's what Triumvirate is. It's a very high-level, sophisticated product for the environmental consumer.
That's our standard piece of propaganda. It gives you a sense of what the company does. We're about $120 million in annual revenue. We've had 600 employees, around 250 of them here in Massachusetts. We operate out of 20 U.S. locations, Canada and in the Bahamas. We operate out of four key industrial verticals: healthcare, life science, higher education, and industrial. We basically do three things. The first is technical services, where we work on clean air, clean water, consulting, develop programs for our customers. We do regulatory training for our customers and assessments of the customer sites. We're involved in waste management. We have a 300 truck fleet that is permitted all over the United States and Canada. We move hazardous waste in barrels. We also move it in bulk. We provide laboratory services and quite a bit of transportation. That's Mrs. Daly. We're in the field service business. Next. This is a quote from Harvard. We've had Harvard as a customer for 25 years, or very close to 25 years. Our aim, our objective with our customers is to get very close to our customers, become an invaluable partner to our customers, and really add value, create value for the customer, and they'll keep coming back and keep paying us. I'd like to tell you a little bit about the company, but I'd also like to share with you a recycling project that I've been working on for the past couple of years that's been really pretty exciting. medical waste occurs in a lot of places, tattoo parlors, dental offices, but in mass, it occurs in hospitals or pharmaceutical companies. Medical waste can be bloody gauze, band-aids, needles, syringes, anything where a medical device or a medical tool interacts with human body liquids is medical waste. And in the United States, we generate a lot of it. Next. So we took some input from our hospital customers, next, from our life science customers, next, and we came to the conclusion that with the current technology that's available, regulated medical waste disposal is expensive and it's really pernicious to the environment. People spend a lot of money on this, and the state of the art is that this stuff is either sent to an incinerator or it's autoclaved, which is a form of high pressure sterilization, and then it's ultimately sent to landfill. And this is billions and billions of pounds. So we developed this program that we call Red to Green. It's a sustainable, cost-effective solution for these people. So this really was an idea born of my colleagues and their customers and conversations that they had, and we have a short film on this as well. And while I'm showing the film, I'm going to do some show and tell and hand some stuff up.
Traditional disposal of regulated medical waste is costly and harmful to the environment. After regulated medical waste was picked up and processed, it was incinerated or dumped into a landfill. Landfills are known for polluting the air and contaminating groundwater, while incineration plants emit ash and gas that negatively impact the atmosphere. What's even worse? This entire process was pricey, burdening medical waste generators with high costs every year. Regulated medical waste was hurting the environment, company recycling goals, and organizations' wallets. That's where Triumvir Environmental came in. With over 100,000 waste management projects under its belt, Triumvir saw a problem and set to fix it. Years of labor went into the development of a red-to-green solution. Now, Triumvir Environmental can offer a new regulated medical waste disposal alternative, saving you from having your waste wind up in an incinerator and then landfill, and instead reusing it in a sustainable way. Here's the process. Regulated medical waste is processed through government-approved sterilizers with FIFRA registered disinfectant. Through a log 6 kill process, your waste gets disinfected. So much so that when the sterilization process is complete, the regulated medical waste is no longer hazardous regulated medical waste at all. It's now a benign, high-grade, raw plastic regrind material. Knowing this, Triumvir dedicated itself to finding a different future for this material. A future that didn't involve red bags combusting and polluting the earth. Why not use this material for something that will benefit rather than hurt the earth? Through the Red to Green solution, Triumvir picks up regulated medical waste at little cost, processes it, and out comes plastic lumber material which is manufactured into heat pumps, farm tools, park benches, and more. Your waste is now restated as something useful. The Red to Green solution is saving the environment one container of regulated medical waste at a time while helping you meet your recycling goals and bottom line, ultimately turning your red into green. Through our Red to Green solution, we're keeping your company cost-efficient and sustainable. Be part of the solution with Red to Green. To learn more about the process or find out how we can help change your regulated medical waste from red to green, call the number on your screen.
Technology. We don't like landfills, the technology either. So what do we have a lot of that we could legitimately turn into something that can be recycled into something that's valuable? And our answer was medical waste. 75% of medical waste is plastic in some form. So what we do with this plastic is we first shred and sterilize it, then we melt it, then we grind up that melt, then we remelt it and form it into quartz. We form it into plastic rubber, which can then be used for a whole lot of things. We bought a facility out in Pittsburgh because we saw our service area in Boston to Chicago, to the east and west, and Nashville to Toronto to the north and south. This was a facility that's in an environmental justice zone, which is shorthand for some of the poorest people in America who live in this community. We went in a little less than a year ago. There were 15 people working in this facility. Today we have it up to 60. Our plan calls us to have 150 employees at this facility, again, in one of the poorest communities in the nation, by the middle of next year. Our process, I won't go into it again. You saw it in the movie, but we take stuff that's really nasty and we turn it into something that people will pay us money for. Here's a slide of some of our products. We can do park benches, planters, all that's one form of picnic table. We probably have three or four different types, styles of picnic tables that we can make. Trash receptacles, speed bumps, parking bollards. I think we have another slide of some more stuff. We can do decks. That's a retaining wall there in the top of the middle. We can do crates. That's a sample of our 4x4 lumber. We're passing a little cross-section of that. We have a very sexy business. We sell to the two largest porta potty makers in the world. We make the floor of the porta potty, and you can kind of see there's some boards on the bottom. So the stuff that really sits in the yuck at Gillette Stadium and at concert venues, that's our stuff that's down there. And then this last picture is some cribbing. It's some cribbing that you see there's a plane that's being jacked up with our stuff. So we make pallets and sort of industrial use stuff. Our product, for the most part, is a substitute for wood. And in the right environments, while it doesn't sort of feel like wood, it doesn't really have all the properties of wood, in the right environments, we need to be resistant to wood boring, pests, termites, etc. Or you're in a place where that has a lot of weather. Customers in Hawaii, customers in the Caribbean, in Florida, who want to use this as a substitute for wood, and that works out pretty nicely. Next. What's in it for our customers? Well, because we're dislocating where our profits come from the front end to the back end, we can offer a lower front end cost for people who are disposing this. We also are offering better treatment technology, one that is recycling rather than disposal, and customers see that as better. Why is it different? It's different from many of the things that we've discussed so far. Next. We've talked about this. And basically, you have something that's not a good technology to something that we feel is a far superior technology. And with that, that's the end of our discussion of the project. I do have one more slide. I do have some tips that before you guys hand me some questions, I figured I'd be wasting my time here if I didn't give you some tips that I learned along the way from BCI through college and grad school to here. My number one tip is work hard. I don't care how smart you are. I don't know how many 4.0 kids are sitting here. No matter how smart you are or how well you're doing here at BCI, or how medium while you're doing here at PCI, there's no substitute for hard work and success in your academic career or beyond. My next thing is get into the very best college you can. Kids spend a lot more time and effort into getting into colleges today than when I was at PCI. But it's a lot more sophisticated, it's a lot more competitive. 20% of the undergraduate seats in America are given away to non-US citizens, so it's 20% harder just on that point alone. So you've got to really, really work hard to get into the best place you can. But of course, once you get into the best place you can, you've got to capitalize on the fact that you're in such a good place. And again, my best advice to you is to work hard when you're there. Don't be a rain cloud. Don't be gloomy as a student. Don't be gloomy as a professional. Nobody likes to work with somebody who's not optimistic. Be very, very ambitious, but keep your ambition in your heart. Not everybody wants to see you wear it on your sleeve. People aren't going to like you very much if they sort of feel that you're a cutthroat, ambitious person. You can be ambitious and keep quiet about it. If you have to, tell somebody that you're ambitious, go home and close your bedroom door and yell it as loud as you want, but it's not really going to get you anywhere, letting everybody know. Over-deliver in everything that you do. And I know when I was in high school, I loved to do the projects and prepare the projects. And most fun ones for me were the ones that I really aired it out and really did a great job. And these are also the ones that I learned the most from. So over-delivering is really, really important. And sometimes you can over-deliver and have a bad outcome. But if you have a bad outcome when you over-deliver, at least you can say to yourself, I tried my absolute hardest and I failed. It's terrible to fail and regret that, if I only put in a few more hours, it would have been better. It's a competitive world out there. And a BCI education is a fantastic thing to be armed with. But a BCI education alone isn't enough. Got to couple it with really digging in and really being a hard worker. And the thing that drives me to be a hard worker is I'm incredibly competitive and I love to win. And if you're incredibly competitive and you love to win, I can tell you that the free market economy that we operate here, not only in the United States but in the world, is getting increasingly more and more and more and more and more competitive. So in order to be successful and continually successful in the future, you've got to be prepared to win more. If you've got to win more, you've got to prepare better. If you've got to prepare better, you've got to work harder. So that's my, those are my tips. And lastly, I think you need to become an expert in something. And people can become experts at a very early age. Mark Zuckerberg is sort of the really obvious contemporary example in the tech world. Bill Gates too was very, very successful at a young age. A lot of people sort of say, well, I'm going to wait until I'm older, 30, 40, 50, 60 years old before I'm a competitor. But you'll be reaching your 20s very, very quickly, and your 20s matter in terms of your professionalism and in terms of your ability to earn money and be successful in your career over time. The more successful you are in your 20s, the more likely you are to be successful later on. So once you leave BCI, finish up strong, get into a great college, work like crazy, get into something that you're passionate about, and become really, really, really good at it, and really, really good at it at a young age. So with that, I think that's I'll advance my own slide. That's it. I'm going to ask for any questions. And before I ask questions, I just want to remind everybody that the sign of a good talk is a lot of questions. So if the talk is only so-so, I'll know. And if it's really good, I'll also know. you have any questions about some of the stuff that I've passed out and passed around, I'd be happy to answer that. I also have some stuff that I didn't pass out, which is stuff that's in research and development right now. We used to not be able to make hollow parts because it's easier to make lumber in the plastic business, but we're sort of experimenting with these rough hollow parts, and this is a prototype. This is a prototype that I made a week ago. And I'm also going to hand up this teeny tiny part. This is called a slider. And it's a really sophisticated small part, and I can't believe that we can make something this sophisticated out of recycled metal waste. This is something that is a load-bearing part that the Walt Disney Company has put into a bunch of crank sliding glass windows and sliding glass doors at some of their resort properties, and I'll just pass this sort of little piece around. We cannot make this today at a high quality, predictable grade, and same with this other hollow piece that I'm passing around, but it is kind of cool that these materials, these waste materials, have properties that we can experiment and sort of do some of this fun stuff with.
So, questions?
What were the things you passed around?
I beg your pardon?
What were the things you passed around?
Okay.
So this thing here is a bag of sterilized medical waste. So this is medical waste after it's been sterilized in our process and ground up. So our process basically puts medical waste into a hopper. The medical waste falls down onto an auger, onto a big screw, and gets shredded up. While it's being shredded, we aliquot in at 7% of the weight of medical waste, calcium oxide, which is an alkaline base that we mist over with water. The water activates the calcium oxide. The calcium oxide, in turn, becomes very, very basic. It becomes, has a pH between 11 and a half and 12. That act of going from neutral to really alkaline flash heats the mixture to about 280 degrees Fahrenheit, and we maintain that heat and that grinding for about 20 minutes. Subsequently, anything that, any bugs, any viruses, any parasites, any bacteria that was once alive and active in medical waste is completely killed. And we have this really cool, fluffy material that we get to work with. Unfortunately, it is so light and fluffy that it